नमस्ते, वेलकम टू एवरीवन टू दिस VTU ई शिक्षणा प्रोग्राम. आई एम डॉक्टर दाक्षायणी आर पाटिल. आई कन्वे मे ग्रीटिंग्स टू एवरीवन. आई एम एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर एट BMS कॉलेज ऑफ आर्किटेक्चर, बुल टेम्पल रोड, बेंगलोर. एंड द कोर्स दैट आई एम डीलिंग विद इज बिल्डिंग सर्विसेज 3, कवरिंग एयर कंडीशनिंग, मैकेनिकल ट्रांसपोर्टेशन एंड फायर प्रोटेक्शन, 18 ARC 63 for the BIAC 6th semester for the term April to August 2021. So far we have started with the course, and I will be handling modules 1 and 2, of which we are in the last section of module 1 in this particular session today. So module 1 deals with mechanical ventilation and basics of air conditioning and refrigeration. Module 2 will address air conditioning systems. So today's session we will be understanding the module 1 section 2, heat load calculations. In the session or class before this particular one, we have seen the various parameters for heat load calculation in a building. The various impacting parameters, like understanding the outdoor design conditions for a given place, the indoor conditions, the internal loads that add to the heat gain, building orientation as per the cardinal directions, building characteristics, the way the architect designs on the materials, the structural design of the building, etc. So today's session we will continue with heat load calculations for the same and understand the various formulas. But before that, we will address one important component of HVAC design, that is thermal zoning, the concept of thermal zoning. So thermal indicates that it is something to do with the sun, solar. Zoning, designing as per certain parameter. So zoning the building based on the thermal heat gain. So thermal zoning definition, it is a method of designing and controlling the HVAC system so that the occupied areas can be maintained at a different temperature than the unoccupied areas using independent setback thermostats. So is it understandable? Thermal zoning. Take a building floor plan, for instance, and we are supposed to design a HVAC system for the building. And what does the term occupied areas refer to? So human height maximum 1.8 plus meters. So this zone that the human, that the users occupy is called as the occupied area in a given building. A ceiling height would normally be 10 feet plus. So what happens about the 2 meter area? It is a non-occupied area. That is one thing. Then there are certain sections of the buildings which do not essentially lead to human occupancy or require the air conditioning. So there are two categories. So occupied areas are primarily the zone, hard hitting zone, where the users are there and their comfort level has to be taken care of. So these zones we will identify, right, in the building, the areas which require AC, the areas which do not require AC, or this area requires this amount of AC and this requires so much. So we will zone the building as per the requirement of temperature to be maintained there when related to the unoccupied areas. So a zone is defined as a space or group of spaces in a building that are having similar heating and cooling requirements so that the comfort conditions may be controlled by a single control thermostat. So one zone, one control. That way we are creating an efficient ecosystem of the HVAC design. So say you have a restaurant design, a 5-star hotel, any restaurant. It will come with its primary areas that are dining space, the lobby area, the pre-entering the dining area. Then you have the kitchen zone, then you might have the service zone. Now, do you think all these areas require the same calibration of HVAC parameters? No. Each zone has its own demand. The dining area where the visitors dine is the zone which requires a maximum comfort condition. The kitchen has a different parameter. It has to be exhausting, the fumes, etc. It is not about comfort. Service areas may not require, they might be the unoccupied areas. So that way you will design a particular building as per the requirement of heating or cooling, as per the activity of the zone. So that comfort conditions may be controlled by a single control thermostat. Moving on, during the cooling load calculations, it is advisable to divide the building into zones. So we are going by a systematic methodology where a large building footprint, we sectorize it or categorize the spaces as per their load requirement. Estimate the building peak load and individual zones airflow rate. So building peak load as per the parameters, the outdoor conditions, the indoor conditions, the altitude, longitude, latitude of the place, etc. And the activities that happen inside, mainly three, the people contributing to the heat, the lights contributing to the heat, and the appliances or the equipment. Building peak load is used for sizing the refrigeration capacity. And individual zone loads are helpful in estimating the airflow rates. So the building peak load, for one thing, will help us estimate the refrigeration capacity or tonnage. How much ton should this zone have? What should be the tonnage for the other zone? Whereas when we do the zoning for individual zones that we have identified and estimated the load for those zones, zone 1, 2, 3, 4. So zone 1 is the dining area, zone 2 is the lobby area, zone 3 is the kitchen area, 4 the service area. So accordingly, X, Y, Z, you are having the loads there. This will help in estimating the air handling capacity parameter. So air handling unit is that component which is the evaporator part of the refrigeration cycle. So what should be the capacity, airflow rate will be estimated. So that is the objective of thermal zoning, which has to be done with precision and with attention to the all the parameters studied in the previous section. The buildings are usually divided into two major zones, exterior and interior. What is exterior zone? The area inward from the outside wall. So take 12 to 18 feet from the outside wall internally. It is directly affected by the outdoor conditions during summer and winter, both the times. So you have a building plan, you have the skin of the building, the walls, the windows, the doors. So considering 12 to 18 feet from that wall, we're talking about large scale buildings. That is the zone that is directly impacted by the outdoor conditions. During summer, it is a zone which incurs the maximum heat. During winters, it is the area that gives out the heat from the inside to outside. So, and we have to reverse that. So exterior zone is the this area. Interior zone, the area that is contained by the exterior zone. So you have the building outline, then you have the 12 feet perimeter along that zone. So any area that is contained within that exterior zone is the interior zone. The interior zone is only slightly affected by outdoor conditions and usually has a uniform cooling, because the exterior zone is now taking care of the insulation. So interior zone is normally the stable, constant cooling load zone. Now we'll talk about two possible models with respect to the building quantum size. Single zone models. These shall be limited to open floor plans with perimeter walls not exceeding 40 feet in length. Single zone, not too big. For large building footprints, assume a minimum of 5 zones per floor. For smaller building floor plans, we need not worry. Okay, we will be calling it as single zone models. But when you are encountering larger floor plate areas, we normally assume 5 zones per floor. So one zone for each of the exposure, right? The four cardinal directions, north, south, east, west. So 4 zones are definitely indicated based on the thermal energy incoming. And then we have that interior zone, which is away from the external wall. So for large building footprints, we will assume such kind of a design. One case study example, this is an office floor with a multi-zone room. So you have the central zone, which is fairly stable and constant, north zone, south zone, west zone, east zone. So did you get 5 zones? As while planning, we need to keep in mind these 5 zones when we are doing large scale building floor plates. And accordingly, our architectural program zoning has to start shaping based on this. Only then can we create energy efficient buildings. Right, shall we move on? Now, architectural design and correlating the perimeter zoning. We have called the outer ring around our building wall as the perimeter. So that is called the envelope perimeter zone. The space 0 to 3 feet from the building shell shall be treated separately in extreme winter and summer climates. So that perimeter zone around the building, especially we are talking about extreme climatic zones and designing in such cities or towns. So you will leave, you will consider that 0 to 3 feet from the building shell as a separate zone, and we will call this as the perimeter zone. Now let us see one case study example, perimeter zoning. So see the blue line, you have the perimeter zone around the north, the directions are written, it's a part plan. So 2 feet envelope zone from wall to control the inside surface temperature and the MRT effect. And how the ducting is happening, flexible ducts there. Then internally there are 2 types of cores happening. Core on the northwest, core on the southeast. And what are the cores essentially handling? They are the AHU services, service shafts, the vertical transportation shaft, staircase, and the his and hers toilet. So 2 cores identified. These will be fairly constant, and moreover they have their own requirement, then you can see the layout of the supply and return air light fixtures that are indicated in the plan. You have the supply duct loop and the return air. So return air is the point where the used air from the space is taken into the air conditioning machine to be treated, to be conditioned. Supply duct loop is a point where clean, cool air is thrown back into the space. So you have to locate these supply and return air grills in a very tactical manner in the fall ceiling. Another indicate the section of the perimeter zoning. It's a section with a floor to floor height of 13.5 feet and floor to the fall ceiling 10 feet. The area below the slab up to the fall ceiling is called as plenum space. So plenum space is a space where the ducts run. The ducts, the terminals, the various shaft related, all the conveying, ducting elements are embedded in the plenum space. So, and you see this 1 to 2 feet envelope zone to the right side from the external wall. So that is the perimeter zone. And we ideally consider it as the non-occupied zone, and it forms like a interface between the out and the in. And there are various parameters written here. We can look at it as a quick case study. There are three perimeter cut zones used here. 1 to 2 is the envelope zone from the wall. So that one, which to control the inside surface temperature. The 15 feet thermal zone from the wall. This one, the green colored zone with the solar and internal heat gains. Then you have the 15 to 25 day lighting zone from the wall. So essentially when we draw sections, we can always consider this kind of a conceptual addressal to the design of the building. And also the calibrations happen when sun is at different angles across the day, and also we could decide on what is the shading parameter, what kind of glass or materials to be used, right? So that is the detailing, and it makes a good case study to understand the perimeter zone, the envelope zone, the thermal zone, and the daylighting zone. Shall I go ahead? Some of the illustrations for different types of buildings, building skin, and the perimeter zones. So you have the envelope of a different design. Then you might have the perimeter zone treated as a small informal landscaped area in your office building. So it acts as the buffer space between the out and the interior zone. Then there are some dynamic plates or dynamic facades also, which toggle during peak summer days and winter days, peak sun rays, and so forth. So looking at case studies and such architectural design elements also is essential. Case studies are very helpful. A quick section on how shading can contribute to diversions in the direct solar gains using the right type of shading. This illustrates two typologies of shading. Because solar energy enters directly, also there is reflective and refractive rays that enter the space, multiplying it. Now coming to the formulas part now, on how we can actually calculate the loads. External cooling load. total cooling load is equal to external loads plus internal loads. Now, visible heat refers to the external loads consisting of heat transfer due to conduction through the building walls, roof, floors, doors. So you will add to this the heat transfer by radiation through fenestrations, openings of various categories, windows, skylights, ventilators, and such, balconies. So sensible heat becomes a summation of external loads in the building due to conduction by the outer skin of the building, and the heat transfer through the glazed openings by radiation. The formula for heat gain is given here. Q heat gain in British thermal unit per hour, U the thermal transmittance of the roof. These are standards which are given in ASHRAE or in any formal standard documents. Area of the roof in square feet, A. Delta T, the temperature difference in degree Fahrenheit. So the basic heat conduction equation for heat gain is given here. The next, the formula is there, but it is modified for a further clarity. Heat gain is converted to cooling load using the room transfer functions. This is called as sol air temperature for rooms with light, medium and heavy thermal characteristics. The equation is modified as Q is equal to U into A into CLTD, where Q means the cooling load, British thermal unit per hour, U is the coefficient of heat transfer through roof or wall or glass, A is the area of the roof in question, and CLTD, the cooling load temperature difference. The values are determined from tables available in ASHRAE Fundamentals Handbook. So what we did is, the heat gain formula that we saw here was modified to accommodate the sol air temperature differences with light, heavy, with light, medium, and heavy thermal characteristics. Now, calculating the total effective room sensible heat gain, ERSH. We are going to see the total that will, all the elements that will give us the effective room sensible heat gain, ERSH. So what will it include? Solar transmission through walls and roof, transmission through glass and partitions, heat gain due to infiltration of fresh air and bypassed fresh air, internal heat gain by people, lights and appliances, and there is a margin of safety that we have to incorporate because nothing is foolproof. Safety factor adding additional 5%. So these 5 parameters have to be calibrated, value found out and added to get the effective room sensible heat gain. The short form is ERSH. Summation of these 5 will give us ERSH. Now how will we calculate the effective room latent heat gain? ELSH. So one is the infiltration fresh air, outside bypassed fresh air. Infiltration is unintended but happens. We outside bypassed air to cool the condenser or the fresh air inlet in the AC unit. People, definitely, people perspire and add to the moisture content of the air along with the temperature rise. Various appliances, they also give out moisture, water vapor into the air. Vapor transmission, and then we add the 5% safety factor. So 5% is the add-on to accommodate any possible errors in calculation. So that is the precision with which the heat load calculation has to be carried out. So now we got the effective room sensible heat gain and effective room latent heat gain. Now we will go to the when you add up both, you will get the total heat gain. Now coming to the calculations, for example, if we were to calculate for the roof, so Q roof, UACLTD, we have seen the formula in the previous slides. So the corrected calculation for the CLTD, temperature difference, is given here, and the parameters listed on what do the nomenclatures mean. Shall I go on? Next element, walls. The cooling load from the walls is treated in a similar way as roof. The formula holds good, and the nomenclatures are listed where Q wall, the Q value is for the wall. It is the load through the walls. U, the thermal transmittance for walls. Now that depends on the material that you've used for the walls. A, area of the walls in square feet. Cooling load temperature and the correction formula. Now, solar load through glass. Now this will have two components: the conductive heat gain by touch of surfaces, solar transmission. The correction values for standard glazing are tabulated in ASHRAE Fundamentals Handbook. The solar load through glass. For solar transmission, the cooling load is calculated by the cooling load SCL factor and shading coefficient. Hence, the cooling load equations under the two aspects of conductive and solar transmission go that way. For the glass conductive Q, U into A into CLTD, the correction for the glass. Q for the solar transmission, A, that is area of the glass, into the shading coefficient into the solar a cooling load factor. Now different types of glasses will have different value outcomes because the SC and the SCL is subjective to the glass used, and also aspects like tinted glass, colored glass will also impact. Additionally, the external factors like shading, tree canopies, vegetation, thickness also impacts the calculation. Now, there are partitions within a building of different materials, ceilings and floors. So the formula Q is equal to U into A into TA minus TRC. U is the coefficient of overall heat transfer between the adjacent and conditioned space. A is the area of the partition or the ceiling or the floor in question, calculated from the building plans. Hence, architectural plans, architectural sections, elevations are very important to be kept ready for calculations of this sort. Temperature of adjacent space. If the adjacent space is not conditioned and the temperature is not available, we can use the outdoor temperature, air temperature, less 5 degrees. TRC, the inside design temperature of conditioned space in degree Fahrenheit. It's an assumed constant. So that was about the sensible and the latent heat cooling loads. Now coming to internal. Sensible and latent heat transfers due to occupants, products, processes, and lighting. Processes in the sense various equipment or appliances. The cooling load is, the lighting load is only sensible. Lights do not give out moisture. Conversion of sensible heat gain to space cooling load is affected by the thermal storage properties or characteristics of that particular space. So cooling load divided by internal gains, you will get the cooling load factors. This is the formula for calculating load due to people or occupants. The factor values are given in the ASHRAE tables, which can be referred. Now, one example of the values given by ASHRAE: heat gain from occupants at various activities. So when you are resting, when a person is resting, when a person is seated and doing very light work, like what I am doing right now, sitting and speaking. When you're sitting and eating, seated, light work, typing, standing, light work or walking slowly, light bench work, light machine work and you're walking, moderate dancing, heavy work, lifting, athletics, and it will tell for adult male what is the value and what is the adjusted value based on the factors that we saw earlier. Sensible heat and the latent heat values. Right? So that was for people. Now for lights. So lights are everywhere in the space. Generally, the instantaneous rate of heat gain from electric lighting may be calculated from the given formula. Cooling load factors are used to convert instantaneous heat gain from lighting to the sensible cooling load. So coming to the total load summation, the first factor was effective room total heat, ERTH, which was the sum total of effective room sensible heat plus effective room latent heat. So ERSH plus ERLH, we get the effective room total heat. Now further to that, the grand total heat, that is the GTH, would be summation of ERTH, the one which we saw on top here, serial number 1, plus the load due to fresh air intake, heat gains in the return air duct or the passages, chilled water system, pump, etc. So the add-on additional heat factors that we had seen in the previous class gets added up to the ERTH to get the grand total heat load. So individually now we have seen step by step on how to calculate the sensible heat and the latent heat for a given building and space. So this was it, the total load summation, ERTH and GTH. So what does it help us in is what we will see now. The effective room total heat will help in determining the quantity and temperature humidity condition of the supply air. Whereas the grand total heat will help us in determining the capacity of the refrigerant plant. So this makes it, we are coming to the bottom line of why we had to take all the exercises on load calculation. So ERTH, the effective room total heat, is going to help us in deciding the quantity and temperature humidity parameters for the supply air that is going to be conditioned and given into the space. Whereas the grand total heat, where we added the additional heat loads, it will help us determine the capacity, the tonnage of the refrigeration plant. So that this was the final objective on why we undertook the exercises for total heat load calculation. Hence, and also heat load estimation form is designed to arrive at these loads and arriving at the conditions of the supply air that is required for a particular project. Alright, so we end the understanding on the heat load and cooling load calculations, a small exercise to arrive to complete the module. Calculate the heat gain loads in your room, or if possible your entire home, using the discussed modes of calculation in the lecture and in reference to the ASHRAE standards. So that would be a nice exercise if each one of you can undertake to get a foothold on how to proceed with the heat load calculations. All right. So this with this session, we end the modules, module 1, section 1 and section 2 for the course Building Services 3. In the next class session, we will be initiating the module 2, section 1, that is types of air conditioning systems. So until then, see you and thank you.